A positive start for Philippine Stock Exchange this week. The local bourse climbed 0.9% to return to the 6,500 level on Monday. Value turnover was at 3.11 billion pesos. The Philippines' vision to improve its credit ratings, threats to the already declining inflation, and how the equities market seen to end the year with First Metro Investment Corporation's Christina Ulang is joining us today on the Business Roadshow. Christina, hi.
Hello, hi.
All right, let's talk about First Metro Investment's GDP outlook for 2023, where you see robust rebound in the second half of the year. What supports the bullishness, Christina?
Mm-hmm. Of course, it's the expectation that inflation is going to temper like 2% towards a year end. So by Christmas, we will all have the purchasing power to buy. So better prices for our holiday goodies. And hopefully El Nino softens towards year end. We don't have this inclement weather towards year end. But no assurance, of course, there is that uncertainties, a lot of uncertainties. And of course, government is spending aggressively on infrastructure. Mm. If we're going to look at the January to May, infrastructure disbursements were like, 10% to 465 billion. But if you're going to look inclusive of the, at a different level, infrastructure and capital outlays, it's up 18% to 365 billion. So I'm citing the statistics from government. Okay. The budget deficit also down. Not because spending is lower, but because our revenue generation is up by 10% to 1.6 trillion. So the fiscal and then the easing inflation, encouraging the household spending towards year end. Hopefully this is going to, of course, the FDI is a bit soft and it's down 18%, but hopefully the consumption, domestic household consumption picks up and help to offset.
Okay, last Friday we had some excitement with inflation numbers going down, but really what's worrisome are some indicators that may affect the downward momentum. Are you monitoring anything closely this August that may impact our downward trend for inflation?
Mm-hmm. Of course, the weather really, it's this, if you notice, all the vegetable prices have started to rise, just because we have this devastation caused by Typhoon Egay. And if you're going to look at cabbage prices, and of course, rice prices globally has posted some upticks. It's good that we have a lot of buffers. And this geopolitical factor in Ukraine, and it's Ukraine now targeting the Russian ports in the Black Sea, causing the grain prices to rise. This is another worrisome factor that can fuel grain prices globally, already fueling actually the rise in grain products globally. So these are some of the worrisome aspects of our inflation trajectory, which hopefully should be like lower towards year.
Okay, let's zero in on rice now, Christina. Rice inflation, a growing concern with Vietnam, now feeling the pangs of El Nino. Now, we've been dependent on Vietnam for rice supply, and now the BSP is even monitoring potential risks to our own inflation numbers once Vietnam tightens the rice exports. Now, what interventions do you want to see from the government side to prepare for this possibility?
I think we have to government has to maybe form a task force to look very closely in the workings of our domestic supply chain, because our supply chain has become very sensitive to all of this reportedly some I'm not saying it, but I'm just hearing this from what is reported by news and media coming from the legislature, reportedly some price manipulation. So I think government should be looking into this and then trying to set up measures so that this onion prices going to as high as like 700 per kilo doesn't repeat itself. And I think that's one. And the second would be the incentives, a lot of incentives in support of the agriculture and farmers. And of course, a lot of improvisation as far as this irrigation is concerned, because we have El Nino, and then a lot of technological support also, and assistance to farmers whose crops are sometimes destroyed, and then they have no capital. I think they need a lot of financial support. I think all of this should form part of the incentivization for farmers to work harder, and then to be in partnership with the government. But of course, what's also important is our buffer stocks. We need to review our buffer stocks. When do we import? How do we forecast our palay harvest? How do we procure? Do we procure more locally? Or what's the role of NFA? I think all of these things need to be redefined, because we are moving in a different environment already.
Right. Okay, let's move on to some of our top stories today. Credit rating ambitions for the Philippines, with the Marcos administration desiring more visibility of the Philippines to credit agencies, aspiring for an A-level, if you will, ratings before Marcos's term ends. Do you see this happening with our ballooning debt?
I think it's not really ballooning. I think it's the nominal number that's ballooning. Yes, agree, 14.1 trillion. But as the economic team has always emphasized, and some opinion coming also from the credit rating agency, what is really important are two ratios. It's really the what's the maturing debt for this year, which is the ratio of your external, the short-term portion of the external debt. It's not even the external debt. Right now, what we have is 118 billion US dollars. Only the portion of that is about to be paid. That's the one that is important in relation to our gross international reserves. Because some people have said that our total external debt is now 118 billion, and our gross international reserves with the central bank is only 100 billion. So our external debt is much higher than our 100 billion gross international reserve. But the credit rating agencies are looking at it in a different way. It's the portion of the external debt that matters, the maturing portion, which I think is small compared to the GIR. I think it's just one third, the maturing portion. And also the debt to GDP, the other ratio, which is important also, the debt to GDP ratio, which is 60%. It's at the threshold, critical threshold, but it's still manageable for us. The critical, should be like towards 70%. We're not in that zone. We are in the safe zone, 60%. Okay. And I think that's manageable for as long as we grow. That has been, I'm just echoing what the economic team has been saying, that for as long as the economy is growing, that's why it's really important to achieve 6% GDP growth. Then we can manage our debt.
All right, that's good to know. Let's talk about your investment house now. It hasn't given up on the dream PSE 7200, 7500. And you know what they say, when it goes up, it could really go up very fast given the right conditions. Now, how is this a possibility now with very little market participation and even catalysts seemingly ignored by the market?
Because, you know, the situation now has changed. Actually, the risk premium now has gone up with the recent downgrade of the U.S. credit rating to like AA plus coming from AAA. This has caused U.S. interest rates to rise. Like the 10-year USD is now doing at 4.1%, and then the 2-year U.S. Treasury is now doing at like 4.8%. So this has raised U.S. interest rates far ahead than what the Fed would like it to be, because it's the Fed that's leading the interest rate trajectory. But now it's the market doing the job of the Fed. The market, U.S. Treasuries are doing the job of the Fed. They're way ahead of the Fed, and now it's a guessing game whether the Fed is still going to hike. But of course, there are some quarters voicing out very hawkish tones, saying that inflation is not yet has not yet been tamed. It's 3%, yes, 3.3%, and yet the core inflation rate in the U.S. is like 4.8%. And I think locally, what the BSP would be evaluating, of course, is the whether they're going to be going ahead of the Fed in terms of the terminal rate, because we're now at 6.25 and the Fed is 5.5, and the differential has narrowed like 75 basis points. So the BSP has to evaluate that. I think the moment the inflation goes down, and the moment that the risk premium on equities drops in sync with lower inflation and in sync with lower key rate by the BSP, or if the BSP starts saying that, oh, it's time for us to to normalize our key rate, our interest rate environment, then I think the risk premium is going to adjust also, and the equity prices will have to price that in. That is not what is in the price now. That's why this is the time to accumulate. You don't accumulate when all the good news are being priced in. You accumulate when all the bad news are being priced in, which is currently now.
Okay, last question, Christina, just one more. Sectors in particular, some analysts are seeing the property sector recovering, but commodities, we're still seeing muted performance in terms of revenues. The latest report to lower bottom lines is, of course, coming from Semirara today, with mining and power units reporting a slip in Q2 earnings. Now, what kind of recovery are you seeing for the commodity sector, and when?
And when? Because there's a confluence of negative information with regard to the China growth trajectory. It has been faltering. Of course, there will be policy support, and therefore onwards, we will see a gradual improvement in the China GDP growth trajectory. But foreign economists are saying, no, it's not going to be a big explosive growth for China because the policy stimulus is going to be very targeted. They're not doing it big time. So it's going to be a gradual recovery, and therefore gradual recovery also for some of the selected maybe copper and maybe for coal. It's not going to be an explosive growth because US also is predicted to enter a slower path of growth. Not necessarily a hard landing, but the scenario is one of soft landing, but still it's soft. Okay. And so that is a negative for the commodities. And but of course the Saudis are very eager to keep the to keep the oil prices very high, like at the $80 per barrel, because that is what's profitable for them, $80 per barrel and above. But Goldman Sachs is saying that towards year end it's going to be higher. It's going to be higher for oil, and I think that's going to pull up also related commodity prices like coal. So until we see a recovery of the global economy, like for next year, when the stimulus kick in, both from the U.S. and China and the rest of those that have seen lower inflation, then that is the time for commodity prices to recover.
All right, that be all for now. Christina Ulong, First Metro Investments Corporation. Hope to see you again soon.
Thank you. Thanks, Stanley. Bye-bye.